Hello, this is the RPG Crawler, and welcome to something that's been coming for a long time. This is a return to RPG Storytime. Now, I've been promising to get to this for months now. It's just that my schedule and a number of other things never fell in place. Now, I promised to tell the story about a fight with a worm that I ran this summer. Basically, I had intended to do this long script that just to make sure I got everything, and it never did come together. I threw away like three copies of the script. So this is me just speaking to you, mostly off script. I've got some notes, and I'm going to go over the entire storyline. Well, not the entire storyline, but most of it from start to finish. Some things to go ahead and get up front. First of all, this all took place in a free-form role-playing channel. Now, running things in a free-form role-playing channel is difficult on the one hand because you don't have a set system by which you can judge success and failure. Rather, a lot of times it's how detailed the posts are and what people's characters can realistically do to respond to them. Anytime you come into a conflict, that's generally what happens. So you can actually run into instances where, you know, one person will say, oh, they're doing one thing, and the other one automatically dodges or whatever that particular thing over and over again. The way we mitigate that in this particular channel is that we have some operators. It's a chat channel, and we have some operators that not only function to keep the various spammers and other disruptive activities out of the channel, but they also serve as game masters, and they kind of moderate based on basically rule of thumb judgment, whether somebody's been avoiding too many things, whether somebody's character has not displayed this power before, and all of a sudden they pull it out of their ass, that sort of thing. And they make judgment calls all the time. So just be aware that this is run in a freeform channel with a effectively a GM-moderated freeform channel. However, a lot of the things I'll go ahead and discuss in terms of the storyline are actually applicable no matter what you do. They're applicable in diced games like D&D just fine. In fact, a lot of this adventure I based on Dungeons & Dragons and then kind of ran it as a rule of thumb with this freeform channel. All right, so on to the story. This freeform channel is set in basically a medieval fantasy city on the coast. And over the years, we've had various major storylines come through, and you have these big bads roll up, and people take a break from their normal role-playing to go ahead and face it. And sometimes these storylines can last for months, or sometimes quite a few bit more than a few months. Basically what you would expect of an ordinary campaign, like a tabletop campaign. If you took all of the tabletop sessions that go into an ordinary campaign and then put them all together so you're playing like almost every day, that's what you're looking at in a lot of these storylines. Now, this particular storyline involves the arrival of a magma dragon. That is a great worm magma dragon to this city. And it's something I came up with off of the fly because I was looking for a character, or I was looking for a threat that I could put against this city that wouldn't be world-shattering, like they don't have to beat it to save the world. Rather, they have to beat it in order to preserve their own homes. If they want to just move out and leave, fine. But the channel is set around this city, so somebody at some point is going to have to go ahead and face this thing. And number two, I wanted it to be challenging enough that in this admittedly really open freeform channel that nobody could go over there and just one-shot it in one go. So I designed this dragon, and I called him Drogyldeve. And the reason I did that is because shortly after I designed the character, I decided to give it a non-D&D twist, and so I looked to Skyrim. There are a lot of Skyrim resources on the web, and one of them was a website that basically has translations of between English and the Thum language, the language of the dragons in Skyrim. And so I had actually used that site to not only create the name, but I used it as a guideline. So when this dragon spoke, because I figured, hey, he's so old, because he's a great worm, he's so old, and he's been out of touch with the local, with the locals so much, that when he speaks, he's speaking, he's not aware of the local tongue. So he's speaking his own tongue, which is going to be a dragon language. But then I figured, well, there's a lot of people that just, as a matter of course, just have their characters speak dragon in the channel. So I go, well, he's old enough that we can presume that he's speaking an older version of dragonish. And so what I did was every time this dragon spoke, he spoke in Thum, and I would run it through the translator. And that kind of cut off on the metagaming with people, because they say, oh, well, I speak dragon. I say, yeah, but do you speak like this ancient dialect of dragon? Well, I said, seriously, you're going to tell me that your character speaks something that hasn't been spoken even among dragons for thousands of years? And when they'd say, oh, I could speak, well, maybe a little of it, I say, fine, you go to this website and you can run this through the translator. It's not a perfect translator. It's not going to give you a perfect translation back and forth. It's going to be like translating something on Google and then translating it back. There's going to be some inaccuracies that creep in. So good luck, basically. And I left them at that. But anyway, I'm getting, you know, ahead of myself. Just keep in mind, it's a great worm magma dragon. Really big, really mean, really challenging. I made him chaotic evil, so he's unpredictable. And he speaks in a language that even the scholars would only barely be able to translate. So the way I started it off was, this storyline lasted for 2 years. And it lasted for 2 years because of a comedy of errors in terms of the scheduling and stuff. But basically one day, you know, everybody's peaceful in this village, in this city, because it is like a metropolis city. Well, as a metropolis as a medieval city can get. So, you know, think several tens of thousands of people in it rather than the millions that you'd see in a modern city. Anyway, so they're all having, you know, a peaceful day one day, and all of a sudden there's like this earthquake, and then it's followed by this other earthquake, and then basically, since it's on the ocean, I thought, what would be a good place to put this dragon's lair since it's coming onto the scene rather than being there already? And so I figured a magma dragon could theoretically come up from a magma bubble. And so what he's done is he's tunneled his way up from the depths of the earth. So this, you know, there's this scene, they've got these earthquakes going on, and it's beginning to cause problems at the seashore because they're starting to get these waves coming in, and they're not full-blown tsunamis, but they're pretty impressive. And then I have this volcano basically erupt from the sea, and then this big-ass dragon comes out, does an overflight of the city, announces his presence. Boom! I'm a fucking dragon, you know. I'll be coming back for tribute. And I have him go back into the sea. And that causes everybody to scramble and stuff, but nobody really pursues it until a couple weeks later, because keep in mind, this is an ongoing thing. There's other things going on in channel. So they got distracted. They're aware that the dragon's out there, but they thought, oh, he flew by. He's not going to do anything. So then a couple weeks later, I run this other event where the dragon comes back over and announces his demands. And prior to announcing his demands, he basically strafes the city with this fire breath. And I'm using variations on this Thum to create like dragon shout type thing, because I figured this is how this dragon manifests his effects, is that he uses Skyrim style dragon shouts, but he's much, much bigger and much, much tougher than any dragon you'll find in Skyrim. So it basically goes over the city, strafes things, and now people are invested. You start having like bards come in to try and counteract the fires he causes. You're having magic users roll up and try and counteract some other fights or some other effects of him being over. And the key in all of this is not that the dragon engaged at this early stage. He didn't engage the characters. He's mobile. He's in the air. He's flying low over the city. He's showing off his sheer power and his bulk. He's a big dragon. He's got a fiery breath. He can shout and effectively disgorge flaming rocks in molten rocks onto things. And in fact, he's so hot that even his proximity will cause things to burst into flames and melt. And it's basically designed to just show that he's there, but he never actually engaged the player characters during all this. Just basically made an ass of himself and showed them that he was there. And this did key them in to try to kill him. And this is like, you know, this is like week two of what ends up being a 2-week siege, or a 2-year siege. And the problem, the reason it took so long to get this dragon down is because we've got players that come in and out at all times. And during that time, we had a bulk of players. I mean, you know, we have a fairly sizable amount of players at any given night. Like right now, as I'm recording this, there are about 40 people in there. Not all of them are playing, but they've got 40 people, many of which have multiple characters at any one time. And then you can guess anywhere from 5 to 12 people in at a time playing, depending on the night. So this is like a continually turning over. It's like figure the biggest D&D group that you could imagine and then doubling that in terms of the characters. Not all of them are combat ready, and not all of them are going to be heroic, but it's kind of like a living city thing where individual groups form to deal with things and then disperse. And some people may form again and again and become like an adventuring party, but overall you've got this broad pool of players to draw from. And at the time, we were in somewhat of a down slump, actually, and we got to as low as about 20 players, of which many weren't actually feeling like playing, because things had been pretty boring lately. But then I introduced the dragon, and at the time, we had some new players. And so they start talking about engaging the dragon, but they don't do it immediately. So, what is a great worm without minions? And what happened was, after that announcement, and then after the initial flyover where he announced his demands, nobody decided to go after him just then. Rather, they decided they would wait until he came to collect his demands in, like, another 2 weeks or whatever. And so, rather, while they waited, he basically spent 2 weeks offshore building up this island through consecutive volcanic events until it finally broke the ocean, and it becomes a proper lair. And on that proper lair, he starts attracting creatures. The problem is that in terms of from a DM's perspective, I was looking for ways to give him minions without necessarily having him request them or having him draw them in. Since it's a new lair, you're not going to have creatures that are already there. Unless, you know, they have a reason to spontaneously arise. And one of the things that spontaneously arises near things like volcanoes, like active volcanoes, are portals to the elemental planes, specifically the planes of fire and earth, and possibly the quasi-elemental plane of magma or whatever. And so what I had was these elementals come in. Salamanders and elementals basically spill through these portals that are spontaneously opening just because there's so much fire and so much magma around. And what they see immediately on arriving at this new island is this big-ass dragon. And so without the dragon say-so, they start forming this cult around here. And this all takes place over the course of about 2 weeks. He gets maybe a couple dozen salamanders and some various elemental hangers-on as his minions. And during this time, the players in the channel were mostly ignoring this dragon building up. I mean, they can see, well, not really see, but the characters can see on the horizon this volcano building up and building up and building up. And they don't actually do anything to go address it. rather one of the new players, and they had like about three or four additional players, and they had just come in to the channel just as that dragon was forming up. So this was their introduction to the channel. They're like, wow, you run Game Mastered events? That's really neat. We'll stick around for a little while. And what they came up with was this idea, because the dragon had demanded tribute. Instead of fighting the dragon, basically they wanted to create like a trap the soul kind of gem that was going to go off. They hid it among the treasure. And that's actually a decent thing. I mean, if you want to go ahead and fuck up somebody who's completely arrogant, just, you know, hide a booby trap in the treasure. And in this case, it was a trap the soul gem. The problem is that the way they did it was they triggered it so it would be the first creature to touch the gem. And before you think I'm metagaming here, they didn't actually tell me this. They discussed it amongst themselves and then, you know, set it aside. And one of the other ops took the information and basically said, okay, I've got their information. And so not knowing this, I thought, you know, when it came time to go to the shore and pick up this tribute, and it's all arranged in boxes and shit on the shore, I thought, well, what would a big dragon who now has a small cult of worshippers do? Would he go start, you know, picking these little treasure chests up himself? Or would he just send his salamanders and say, go get, you want to prove your worth, go get that shit. So I had him do the latter. So I'm in this by now, this dragon's been out there almost a month in real time, because this is all played out in real time. Where people, you know, come in and then they play some scenes and come out. And I can only really count on a full group of people being there a couple days a week. So it is kind of like, you know, your standard adventuring group, but with additional stuff that can be taken during the downtime days. Anyway, so he sends out his minions, and the minions get to shore and they start loading up this treasure. And immediately these new people start crying foul. Oh, he said he'd come collect the tribute. And I was like, well, he's collecting the tribute. And they immediately threw this fit, like all of these new people. And the people who had been in the channel were wondering, what the hell are these guys talking about? Why are they making such a stink? And I said, well, he sent his minions to collect the treasure. To which their reply was, no, he said he would collect the treasure. And then I find out, you know, he didn't collect the treasure. He sent his minions to collect the treasure. And then that's when I find out they had rigged the gem to go off on the first creature that touches it, because it immediately goes off on one of the salamanders. You know, one of the other operators that was handling their information tells me, oh, well, they got to trap the soul in there, and it just tries to trap on your salamanders. And I'm sitting there taken aback, going, well, that was a neat trap, but you caught one of the salamanders. What was, you know, I understand your purpose. But they would not drop it. They were screaming and shrieking in, well, they were not screaming and shrieking because it's a text-based medium, but they were, you know, typing all caps and really, really genuinely upset that I had this chaotic, evil monster not personally come and collect the treasure because the monster said he would. That was their reasoning. They said, oh, he said he would. So you're breaking the rules by not having him do this. And I'm like, well, first of all, he's got minions there for a reason, so they can do the grunt work. But second of all, what the fuck, man? He's chaotic evil. You're expecting him to keep his word, and then you're making like an out-of-character stink that a chaotic evil monster said he was going to do something and didn't. What the fuck? Anyway, so what happened then is they left, and that cut down on the number of people that were involved in the dragon plot, like, real quick. Because we still had people, but I had designed it for the people who were active at that time, and they no longer had the firepower, basically, to take this thing out. So I was like, uh-oh. Now, we run a persistent world here, and I've had a dragon show up, and I don't have the firepower to take that thing out. One moment. Just drinking my water. Anyway. So, what do I do now? I can't just have... I mean, the dragon's got his tribute, but he's also sticking around. So what I did was I made it so he would come to collect tribute every quarter. Every season, basically. So he'd come during the winter, he'd come during the spring, and so forth. And that let me basically put him on the back burner because he'd received the tribute. I mean, the initial trap pissed him off. But it gave me the opportunity to have him go back to the island and basically retreat for a couple months. So I did that. You know, over the next couple months, we got more players in and we got some old ones coming back and they formed up a new team. And then the next month going on, they had that team go out there to try to fight this dragon when he sent his minions for the next tribute. And so his minions come up, and they decide, okay, we're going to fight these minions. But, and this is by now, we're now like 2 months into this, what eventually became a 2-year storyline, but now they're 2 months in the storyline. But the problem is that the new players that had decided to go ahead, or new and old players who had decided to go ahead and face these people, you know, who were coming to extort this money from the city and pick up the tribute design, they didn't really discuss a whole lot with one another. And so what you ended up with was basically, instead of having like a united front, they just had these characters scattered here and there in a crowd, all acting independently with no coordination. And the first thing that they did when these salamanders rose up from the ocean to go collect the tribute, really fascinating visual, by the way. I had all these descriptives done where these salamanders slithered down from the volcano and into the water, kind of like snakes of fire, like you'd see like as if it were an actual volcanic eruption with the lava flowing down, except they're actually salamanders and glowing under the ocean and basically squiggling up towards the shore. But anyway, I digress. So the first person to jump out and assault these salamanders did so with fire magic. And I don't know if they were unaware that... I don't know if they were unaware that salamanders, with their fiery auras and bodies of flame and glowing red scales, were fire-based, or whether they thought simply because it was a freeform channel that they could use fire to damage fire creatures. But long story short, they basically threw all this fire and kind of got upset when the other game masters were like, they're immune to fire. They're fire creatures. They're made of fire. So they basically shrug it off. And so that attack didn't go too well. Although what it did end up happening was that they pissed the salamanders off. And though they ended up basically driving the salamanders back into the sea, but it was a real clusterfuck. It only really kind of came into focus when one of the standby mages went ahead and started using like frost spells, and that's when they drove the salamanders off. So they drove the salamanders off without their tribute. But they never actually went, because they were so disorganized, they didn't follow it up. They were like, yay, we drove the salamanders off, now let's all go get a beer. And so they really didn't think about what would happen, you know, what a worm would do when he discovers that his attempt to gather tribute was just, you know, met with a brick wall. So the next day, this worm, who has been basically sitting on his island for 2 weeks, aside from that initial attack, he'd not really done a whole lot. So he attacks the city in force. I have, his salamanders start going into the sewers because there's sewer access near the ocean. And from beneath the city, these salamanders basically set up summoning portals. And they start pulling over actual elementals underneath the city. So all of a sudden, the city's got all these fire elementals popping out of manholes and shit. And then the worm comes by, and he doesn't do much. He strafes the city like 3 times. And he just burns this swath of about a third of the city. Just a third of the city is in flames. He does a strafing run of the docks. And at this point, you know, when I triggered it, and there are like about 9 people in channel. And that's a pretty sizable chunk. You'd think 9 people would be able to mount some sort of defense or whatever. Even against something of this size, 9 people might be able to, you know, engage it. They don't. In fact, many of them don't engage it. In fact, almost all of the characters in the channel at that time, and some of them were pretty solid characters, some of them were characters that you would, if they were translated to a dice game, would be high end. I mean, they would be in their level 15, level 16. Maybe not great worm material, but enough to, you know, do some damage to something that's just flying by. They run. Most of them have their characters just book it and start running and taking shelter. And so I am just sitting here boggled because I'm expecting them to actually mount some sort of, you know, something to help save the city so I don't just have to play it like a puppet show with the NPCs versus the dragon while everybody just kind of washes on. And I'm like, holy shit, did I misread these people? Eventually, a couple people, including a bard, come up and they start controlling the fires. And they, you know, there's a bard and a druid and somebody else got together and started basically fighting the fires and driving the elementals back. But at this point, this is the second time I've had this dragon come out and people basically fail to engage it. And I'm beginning to have, at this point, I'm beginning to have second thoughts about running this particular storyline. Keeping in mind that before I'd done this, it had been so slow that people were begging me to run something in channel. Just, you know, something that was GM focused that would get their attention. And when I finally broke down and did it, no one wanted to fight the damn thing. So basically that engagement ended with the dragon retreating to his lair and letting the city just burn for a while. They eventually got the fires under control, and then I ran this kind of mini thing just to get people into the spirit of things, where people would go down into the sewers and fight these elementals, you know, and close these gates. And wow, I'm about half an hour in. I haven't even started the worm fight. This is all background information. This is all shit. This worm is basically sieging this city. And so for the next year and a half, this worm shows up every season and demands his tribute. And after that initial, you know, rejection, nobody really fought the worm again until near the end. They basically let it have its tribute. A couple times I got to run, you know, and they were basically resigned to, hey, well, it's not us paying the tribute, just the NPCs paying the tribute. Why would we even bother to get involved? We'll just, you know, salute the dragon as it flies over and let it collect its shit. And so nobody fought this thing for the longest time. They were just letting it collect its tribute. Now, a couple times I did get to make use of this as like a backdrop storyline where somebody would like try to rob the tribute, and then the players would get involved. They'd send their people out to go ahead and fight the people that were trying to rob the tribute train. But they never actually wanted to bother with the dragon anymore. So things progressed on and on. And a couple people had a couple weird ideas. We had one person in channel that plays this kind of insane survivalist type. And instead of fighting the dragon, he just wanted to make sure that the sewers didn't end up being filled with summoning portals again. So he tried to get permission to drain the river that runs through the city directly through the sewers, like build a diversion channel. And when everybody said, no, that's not a great idea, why would we let you flood the sewers? He started digging a hole himself. And I was sitting there going, you know that one man with a pickaxe digging a tunnel large enough to do that by himself is going to take a while. So he said, oh, don't worry, I'll try it. And I did the math, and it ended up being like something close to like 10 months. So I said, well, if that's what you want, go ahead. And everybody kind of laughed. And we were expecting this storyline to be over quickly. So this went on for some time. So I wasn't expecting this thing to take 10 months. So everybody kind of laughed. But since the dragon was only showing up every quarter, people were getting complacent and basically just letting it come in. And so for the next year and a half, pretty much nobody did anything. And so, you know, I was letting it be known that the dragon was still around. And I was letting it be known that his depredations were really hurting the city. But nobody really acted. But during that year, we had a number of old players come back and a number of new players come in. And we were recruiting players until we got to roughly about where we are now. Where we're getting like a dozen people in, you know, over the course of a day in various instances of role play. And you've got like a pool of about 40 people to draw on. And at this point, there's quite a few characters to draw on. And they just started deciding, hey, maybe we may want to go ahead and start in on this dragon. But they didn't act. And so finally, I had one of those things where the dragon's minions show up for the for the tribute. And what I did was I had another villain come in and try to steal the tribute. This time, during the distraction, the tribute got knocked off of the dock, and so that was enough. And that was during collection. So the salamanders figured, hey, these guys are starting to fuck with us again. And they confronted the crowd, at which point the crowd that had been gathering, they actually attacked the salamanders this time again. So by now a year and a half has passed, you know, of regular tributes and not really facing any resistance. And this time, being a little bit more, a little bit better organized, they did much better, and they actually took some of these salamanders down. So the remaining salamanders took what tribute they could fish off the bottom of the docks, and the bottom of the harbor, and then, you know, swam back to report. So that triggers, you know, the worm coming up for another reminder that he's there. And this time the salamanders didn't infest the sewers, but the worm starts swinging by. And he does a once over the city, and he burns some of the city, and starts heading back towards, you know, his volcano. And this is one event in all of this time. You know, after a year and a half time, I had all these events, but this is another event that bears going into, because we had another group of characters come into the channel recently, and they were like as a family, and what they had done was they had fled from another place that had undertaken some dragon attack or something. I don't know. I'm not really clear on it, but they're basically refugees. So they had set up a camp on the beach. And so one character who is a known, not necessarily a troublemaker, but tends to act before thinking, is called Trace. I believe that's the character's name. And he's a mage. He's a mage of fairly decent power. But he is over near where this family has set up camp and is starting to build their houses and stuff. And he sees this dragon flying off from the city. And what does he do? All by his lonesome, he pegs the dragon in the back of the head with a spell. And so everybody, you know, all the characters who were in this little like cove area where he's standing, that were building their, you know, the refugees that were building their houses, kind of turned and looked at him, going, "What the hell are you doing?" And then I've got the dragon, and, you know, I said the dragon speaks Thum, so I'm like, "Really? really, somebody just did that? Except in Thum, so everybody's kind of wondering what the hell, except for like the two people that actually bothered to look it up, and they're laughing their asses off. So at this point, the Wyrm, after already demonstrating that he can damage the city, turns around and starts flying in to do this attack on the cove. But this cove's like in this enclosed cliff area. And so this one mage is all beefing up like he's going to go ahead and take this Wyrm out himself. Like it's actually going to engage him in melee or something. But dragons don't do that. So what I did was I had this dragon, you know, the dragon is smart. He's not only smart, but he's powerful. You know, he's not brilliant, but he's reasonably intelligent. He's powerful. He has a fair command of the way that his auras, his heat, his flame, his magma breath, whatever, interacts with his surroundings, especially the sea, because he's living on an island. And so this Wyrm comes in, and instead of strafing them this time, plunges into the water and does a magma breath under the water near the beach. And so the mage is sitting there going, what just happened? He didn't pass over me. He was preparing to, do short-range spells as the Wyrm was passing over. No, instead, what happens when you have that much magma all of a sudden appear under seawater is that seawater starts boiling and flashing into steam. And then the Wyrm basically uses wings to push all that steam and boiling seawater up into the cove. And all of this time, all the people who were trying to shelter there were running and screaming. And the mage says, oh, shit. And he starts, protecting himself with shields. And all the rest of the people all the rest of the PCs are still back in the city, which is down the beach. And they're kind of gathering on the wharf going, what the hell is going on over there? Who pissed the dragon off over there? And so this dragon does eventually, do one more breath weapon into that cove. So it's just a mess of steam, of magma, of fire, of poisonous gas, just covering not poisonous gas, but, volcanic ash and gas, which is, pretty freaking deadly. Just all in this area where these poor refugees had been staying. And the only one that they have left to blame is this damn mage. And then the dragon flies off to where he's going. Back to his island, considering the day done. And, on the way, I've seen things might have been before this. This setting has this castle up on a cliff. And it's kind of like a figurehead castle, just like... No royals really live there full time, but it's where the treasury is and where the governor stays. And it's basically a really symbolic castle. So this dragon does take the time to go over there and basically throw up magma into this castle. So you have this scenic picture of this dragon coming out of the sea up on this cliff, leaning over the outer court and walls and just going, bleh. And just basically barfing magma into this poor castle that has absolutely nothing to do with the rest of things. It's just a symbolic act. And at this point, the players start getting pissed off. And they start going, okay, we got to do something about that dragon. Finally, they start thinking about launching the assault. So in the days leading up to this assault, things are starting to quiet down. They've put out all the fires in the city. They have this collection of people that's starting to be put together by one of the characters. And that character is Varatrix. I think that's how you pronounce it. And she is a dark elven rogue. And you wouldn't expect that to be particularly heroic. In fact, she's not necessarily good aligned. But she saw the damage that this Wyrm did. And it was like one of those moment of truth things where like, oh my God, this is so destructive. We need to do something about it, even though I'm not a hero. And it was actually a really good bit of character development. So she starts putting together this, this big organized assault. And they prepare for it for a few days. And as part of that, actually, it's more than a few days. They've already given, at this point, they've already given the tribute. So they've got like, They know they've got months to prepare. So they contact another character that's in the setting. And I believe it's called Juskard. I don't know how to pronounce that exactly, but he's basically an old retired warrior monk that has become a blacksmith, and he creates these weapons of legend. And they say, okay, Juskard, we need something that'll basically a dragon slaying weapon. So he creates this artifact level polearm that can actually craft, that can actually make big glacial spikes and shit as it's being used. And he goes ahead and he makes it. Meanwhile, you know, Varatrix goes around and starts recruiting people for an eventual assault on the island. And this is where things get interesting, because as soon as that weapon's done, you know, instead of holding it in reserve and using it against the worm, Juskard walks out onto the beach, and he hefts, you know, alone, and he hefts this artifact weapon. And he uses it to create basically a big-ass iceberg that he drops into the sea. And I'm like, you know, I don't want to say anything, but you realize the worm can see that, right? Except I can't actually say that, but everybody, I don't have to say it because everybody else is in the background going, did he just do that? Did he just demonstrate their secret? Did he just demonstrate their secret weapon in full view of the fucking worm? Apparently so. So there goes their surprise. On that. And then while Varatrix is basically trying to recover from that, going, what the fuck did you do? Another character, and I'm not going to give this character away, but another character plays a dragon in town. And this is a much smaller dragon. He's a PC dragon. And so what he does is, of his own accord, he goes to fly out to the island to try to befriend this worm. And basically give him misinformation and or... I don't know what he was trying to do. Because the misinformation that he gave the worm was actual valid information. But he said he was basically... I don't know. This dragon doesn't make sense. But he goes over to the dragon. First of all, he approaches the dragon with all the arrogance of a dragon that a dragon might offer. And the problem is that he's this relatively small dragon, say only about the size of, you know, a few... maybe the size of an elephant, if that, which is small for a dragon. And then you've got this big towering worm just kind of looking at him like, what the fuck are you doing, boy? but this little dragon was saying, oh, I can help you. I can go ahead and give you information. But he'd approached him with such an attitude, the worm was facing basically like, look, I didn't ask for your help. I don't need your help. What you need to do is go back to town before you piss me off. To which the little dragon basically mouthed off. Which leads me to one of the glorious scenes in this entire, you know, extended campaign. Remember that I said this: the main worm, Drogyaldeev, was based on Skyrim dragons. So I got to bust out the Fusro Da. And so, I admit I did it for comedy effects. This the worm basically, Fusro Da, and sends this little dragon ass over head, tumbling, just ragdolling all the way back to town. And it was enough for the, you know, it was comedic factor. The rest of the players basically busted out laughing in the out of character channel we have. And it was a great scene. But he returned the next day or whatever, and what he did was he basically gave this dragon like 3 days. This little dragon gave the great worm 3 days warning that he was about to be attacked. 3 days warning. So the worm, now that he's got 3 days warning, and now that his minions have 3 days warning, know that, oh well, maybe I can go ahead and, you know, make this place, you know, secure this place. I've been here a year and a half, 2 years now. This one's verging on 2 years. Nobody's touched me. But it wouldn't hurt to add a few defenses. So in those 3 days, what they do is, the worm doesn't do much. He basically goes around flicking off bits of rock so that the the salamanders can build things out of it. And what the salamanders do is they use those 3 days to do two things. First, they craft a sort of seawall around the island. It's not big. It's about three to five feet, depending on where it is. And it's all out of just crude obsidian slabs. It's enough so that it's going to make landing interesting. And then what they do is they craft 4 portals to the elemental realm of fire. And they put each of these portals really obviously on the island. I mean, they've got like a doldron. They've got like a, they've got basically like a standing stone structure around them. But otherwise, they're open to the air. Anybody can see them as long as they're near the island. And but they've got all this time because this little dragon basically tipped him off in his misguided attempt to I don't know what he was attempting to do, but in his misguided way, he basically gave him 3 days to go ahead and make the battle that was already going to be really rough that much rougher. So finally, the day comes where they're ready to engage the dragon. And they send somebody out to scout, which is a good thing. When you're about to face something as big as a great worm, you want to have all the information available. So they send somebody out to scout. They send Trace, the mage that had fucked up and triggered the dragon assaulting that cove. They say, hey, look, he went out to scout just to basically to make up for the damage he did. And that was cool of him. So he goes around the island and he approaches and he sees all of this stuff. And he heads back to town. Scouting mission is done. He doesn't tell anybody. He sees the gates. He sees the seawall. He doesn't tell anybody about it. He gets to town and he tells the rest of the group, oh, well, they've got salamanders there. Well, we knew we had salamanders there. Is that all? Yeah. Fucking A. Choose your scouts carefully. So at the end of the day, they go ahead and pour into these boats. And there's a lot of player characters involved at this point. And I've got my notes here. You've got Varatrix, the dark elven rogue woman. She's kind of like an old school dungeon crawling sort. Akintunde, I don't know how to pronounce that. He was a warrior mage that was so new at the time as a character that I honestly didn't have a grasp of what he could do, and he didn't stick around thereafter. He's one of those guys that showed up and, like, on his 3rd or 4th day, they're going to fight a dragon, so, you know, them. Then you have Juskar, the blacksmith I spoke of, and since he had created that artifact, what he did was he said, well, you know what, I'm going to own up to the fact that I showed this off, and I'm going to basically use my character and his artifact to draw the dragon's fire. So he salvaged that much out of it. Then you have Drama, who is, I think that's how you pronounce it, Drama. I think it's actually Drama, but a tiefling support type character. She's not front and center, but she's basically an administrator. But she stays back and she starts assembling their backup teams of NPCs, because they've not only got a huge team of player characters, but they've got some NPC bands that are going in as well that they raised during all this. You've got Trace, who was the mage. He's focused on teleportations and energy manipulation. You have Azalea, who is a fairy healer who basically tagged along in the hopes to get to heal somebody. There was Phobos, who was an elven warrior thief woman, who was also brand new, like Akintunde, except I think she actually left the channel like shortly thereafter as well. And then you have Kivari, who was a mage sort, but she worked at the city's tax office. So she's kind of this government official with mage powers. And then you had a couple player characters who wanted to be there but couldn't be there at the time. And one of them especially, we let her be NPC'd, because a lot of this tactic was that when they watched the dragon going along, they realized that he said something every time that he used a breath weapon. So what they intended to do was have this player character, Jackal, who is an elven mage, who assemble a team of other mages. And basically the plan was to get them out there on a boat and have them cast a big silence spell on the dragon. enough to keep it from using its voice. And there was a limited range on it, but that range was extended because of all of the mage, you know, all the mages helping out. But it wasn't infinite. It couldn't reach the island and town at once, but it could reach a fair amount. But since that the player couldn't make it, I allowed this character to be part of the NPC team and be among the NPCs. Aside from that, there were a number of other NPCs. There were volunteers from the local town guard to basically reinforce the melee attacks. So if somebody attacked something, they could be sure to have some NPC guards behind them. There was a number of mages from the town to help guard Jaquel with her planned role and to assist. And I did end up adding a DMPC of my own. And I don't like doing that. But one of the characters that I play is well known in the city, and he's kind of a noble, kind of an evil noble, but he's a noble. So noblesse oblige or whatever, he would have felt compelled to send somebody with the group to challenge the dragon. So I threw in Bob the Goblin, a goblin warrior of exceptional durability, whom I admit to only throwing in there so that he could fall prey to traps. So, we've got all of these people piled into several boats, and they go out to the island. And as they're going out, everybody's in their boats except for Kavari, who can fly, and she's tailing the boats invisibly. And then Giscard, who has, you know, the big pole arm, he's on a flying carpet, and he's heading up hidden, basically. But the problem is that the little dragon had given him this warning, had also pretty much given him a sign on what to look at, accidentally, not intending to. He said, oh, these people are coming. And so when they see these boats starting out, the worm, who has not made an appearance yet in this particular fight, basically blows the top off of his volcano and just peppers the sea around his island with big, jagged, molten rocks sticking out of... Well, not molten, but big, jagged, burning rocks sticking out of the water. So imagine this. What you have on the island are four gates to the elemental plane of fire. Fire elementals coming out of those gates. You've got a number of random regular salamanders, but then you also have the salamander's leader, who is the cult leader, who is a salamander priest, who calls himself the Voice. And he's got, because he speaks on behalf of the dragon, even though he speaks on behalf of the worm, even though the worm wouldn't give him the time of day usually. And then you've got a group of six elite salamander guards. And then you've got the worm himself, who still hasn't shown up because he's deep within his lair. And so what I do is I hand off these groups to the different dungeon masters, because we've got a handful of ops in this channel. So I go, okay, you want to do something, you play these guys. You want to do something, you play these guys, and I'll play these guys. And so, you know, you've got a really big mix of characters in here. You know, some people, you know, some NPCs, some player characters. It was just this big, massive fight brewing up. So, first of all, the player characters from town, the heroes from town, you know, they row off towards this island in their boats, and they immediately discover something. First of all, the sea around an active volcano can be kind of caustic, so it immediately starts, you know, eating away at their wooden boats. Not only that, but it's also boiling hot. So you've got this instance where they had been intending to ditch the boats. They'd been intending to run the boats right onto shore, not ditch them. But as they approach the island, they realize, number one, there's a seawall all the way around the island. It's not a high one, but it's big enough that they're going to have problems getting their boats. They're going to have to actually climb up on the seawall, and they've got salamanders along the top of the seawall ready to stab down at them when they beach. But they also have these big, jagged rocks sticking out everywhere now. So they can't even approach the seawall but for the space, you know, without running their boats aground. So they say, oh, well, we're going to go ahead and start circling the island and find out a place to land. And I'm like, well, number one, it would have been nice for your mage to figure out a place to land, but he didn't. And if he did, he didn't tell you. And number two, your boats aren't going to last that long, because now that you're close enough for that boiling water and that volcanic in that mix of that acidic mix to start hitting the hulls of your crudely constructed rowboats, basically. They're not going to last that long. And in fact, you're already getting the interior of the boats to heat up as is. And so what they did was they needed to know what would happen if they went into the water. And so Bob the Goblin got out and fell in the water, and he starts boiling. He's screaming and boiling, and help me, help me. And they're like, well, that's not going to work. So then some of the boats had been outfitted with ballista, and basically pulled one of these ballista back and said, you know what, let's fire a ballista bolt. Get it lodged in there, you know, with a rope behind it, and pull ourselves in. That way, even if our boat starts falling apart, we can haul on it and get it up to that seawall without problems. In the meantime, I'm going... you've got mages, but I can't really... I'm not giving them any clues, but they've got mages. And in fact... a lot of them are invisible right now, because most of these boats are hidden with invisibility spells that last quite some time. They could have levitated the boats or something. It would have got them across, but nobody thought about that. All they thought about is, hey, we can run these boats up here and climb out. So one of the people says, okay, I've got the ballista loaded. I've got a rope tied to it. I'm going to fire it at the island. And I say, oh, at the island? Where at the island? Is it going to be the seawall, which is like solid obsidian slabs? Or are you going to fire it at the slope of the island, which is like a volcanic cone? It looks like a soft ground, and it's cracked here and there, and you can see magma kind of pour, or lava coming out here and there. And they say, well, I'm going to fire it at the soft-looking ground. I'm like, okay. And so, you know, it's not diced. I let them have it. They fire it at the volcanic slope. And the ballista bolt punches through the thin layer and starts catching fire. And this reveals the ship. So immediately, you know, all of these salamanders and elementals, you know, see one of the boats. They're not ships, they're boats. And so now the battle is on. They realize they fucked up. They do eventually get to shore, and the way they do it is they have another ballista bolt fire, and they haul it in, and another of the boats realizes that they have a magic user aboard, so they just levitate there, and they say, and the rest of the people are like, oh, why didn't we do that in the first place? I'm like, yeah, why didn't you do that in the first place? But they get on the island for the most part. The only people still out to sea are the mages sitting in one of those boats, ready to silence the worm when it appears. So cue this big clusterfuck of a fight where you've got guards and you've got player characters and you've got elementals and you've got salamanders all going at each other. And since it's not diced, we did a lot of rule of thumbing. Like we'd say, oh, these people are fighting these people. And then we'd handle each of the PC's actions and turns. And I'm sitting there going, yeah. And as you're fighting, you know, more of these elementals spill out of the portals. And nobody really pays attention to those portals. And so they fight and they kill a lot of elementals and they kill a lot of salamanders. I'm like, well, every time you slay a salamander, you see him, you know, disappear in a puff of flames. Foosh. He's an elemental creature. He goes back to the elemental plane. And they're like, okay, okay. I even use those terms. Like, you successfully kill a salamander and send him back to the elemental plane. And all the while... you know, every round, because we're doing this in rounds, and every round I'm saying, and from the portals, more salamanders and elementals appear. And they aren't getting it. And so they continue for like an hour and a half, just going, oh, we're making no progress, just bitching and moaning about not making any progress. And Giscard comes out with that big pole arm. And he comes out of the sky and starts engaging the main priest and his guards. And still the worm hasn't appeared. So Giscard's fighting, you know, the priest and the elite guards. The rest of the people are chewing through the regular salamanders and coming after the elite guards. And it's like every time one of these things drops, another slithers out of these portals, and nobody's doing anything about the portals. Until finally, Giscard gets the upper hand and kills the priest. And the priest disappears in a cloud of smoke. And they're like, yay, we're making progress. And then they kill some of the elites, and they disappear in clouds of flame. And they're like, yay, we're making progress. And the next turn, I'm like, a familiar salamander priest and two familiar salamander guards come out of one of the portals. And they don't get it. They're like, fuck, another one. And I'm like, fuck me. So they fight the new salamander priest and the new elite guards, and they kill them. Again. And the next round, a strangely familiar salamander priest and some more elite guards pour out of the portals. Finally at this point, and we're like an hour and a half plus, almost 2 hours into this damn fight. Finally somebody gets it. And she's like, and it was Kavari, and she has flight, and she was hanging back, and she was like, God, you people are idiots! And she started going and working on closing the portals. And at this point, Trace, who is a mage who specializes in teleportation, realizes, oh, maybe we should close the portal. So he's going around. And so over the next two rounds, they manage to close these portals off. And they still haven't got to the fucking dragon fight. And at this point, I'm like, man, am I even going to have time to run the dragon fight? Because this fight has taken an hour longer than I thought it would, even including the dragon, just because nobody really planned ahead. And then when they got to the island, nobody really paid attention to the fact that the shit that they were killing was immediately just coming back from the plane of fire through the open portals. And so finally they get the portals closed and they get the priest banished. And, you know, Giscard walks up there and he lifts his pole arm and he's like, I challenge you. Come out here, worm. And all of this time during this fight, I probably should have told this before, all this time during this fight, this island is kind of rocking back and forth under their feet and they're wondering why. And it soon becomes clear why. It's because the worm was making a magma bulge on one side of the island. So when Giscard makes that challenge and everybody's ready to fight the worm on the island, what does the worm do? He blows out from the bottom of the island and goes in a streak out of the sea and into the air. And everybody turns to look at this worm. And they realize, oh fuck, it's heading for the city. So the island begins to collapse slowly. He's not a load-bearing boss. The worm blew out the bottom of the island. And as a result, this island is basically beginning to crumble and collapse back into the sea a little bit. And all of the characters are on the island. And the mages that they had been counting on to silence this worm are near the island. And where is the worm? He's all the way across the bay and in the city. So this worm basically has free range for like 3 to 4 rounds, just toasting ships and roasting buildings and just flying back and forth over the city and setting huge amounts of fires. And so what the groups do is they realize, shit, we need to get back. So finally the mages make themselves useful and they open up portals to go back to the city. And everybody's looking at these portals going, couldn't you have done that to get us out here in the first place? But no, it's cool. So they all start pouring through these portals, get back to the city. once they're in the city, the dragon's tearing overhead. And I make it a point, because I'm a bastard that way, to have every time I have an airborne villain or an airborne thing of any real merit, to have it clip the top of the royal church and knock the steeple off. So I as an aside, I imagine that the head of the royal church has repaired the church steeple as the shit job that he gives the acolytes that he doesn't like. Because every time there's a villain or anything, it's like, boom, there goes the steeple. So they pour out of these gates and they go to engage it. And at this point, because they're so scattered, some of these player characters take off at this point, because this fight has been going on for hours now. We're into hour two, going on hour three by this point. And a lot of them realize, hey, we can't actually keep up with the dragon. Now it's airborne and shit. But eventually they do get a couple people in there who can actually keep up with it. They've got Juskard. They've got the mages. I think Varatrix actually had some sort of flight spell on her at this point. Azalea was left behind. She was just like, oh, I'm going to stay behind and heal people. And at this point, because they're in the city, the ranking priest in the royal church, who is called Anias, he's an elven druid. And he's a pretty high level elven druid. So he can actually enter the battle now, because they just fucked with his church. So he walks out. And so you have this instance where finally, after much, much ado, after the fight on the island taking so much time, the mages drop their silence on Drogeldeev. And he sweeps by and he tries to use his flame, his shouts, and nothing happens. And he's like, oh shit. But he's still a dragon. He's still big. He's still powerful. But at this point, with his shouts basically drawn back, the remaining characters were tired of this thing. And they were like, let's work together for once. So they had Juskard got a few good licks in with his pole arm, his ice-based thing. And at this point, they're throwing ice magics at him left and right, but they're not really having the effect that they thought that they might. And the secret is that worms generally have treasures in their hoard. And a worm that's been around for about only a year and a half in the area has probably had time to have an item or two crafted out of the treasure, out of the tribute that he's been getting. So one of the items that the magma worm had crafted for himself was basically a ring of frost resistance, because I'm a bastard that way. So they were sitting there bouncing these spells off of this guy, bouncing these ice effects off this guy, going, ice doesn't hit him either, what the fuck? And then finally, one of the lower level mages that was with the group, not an NPC, but one of the people I'd mentioned, can't remember which one, thought to go, one of the lower level mages was noticing that the druid spells, Anias's lightning was hitting the thing and causing a lot of damage, but the ice spells weren't, and everybody was concentrating on ice. And then so this lower end mage was basically like, I detect magic on him. I'm like, okay, you note that he's got a band of gold around his neck that you really didn't see that should be melted because of how hot he is. That's magical. And you see like an iron band along one of his claws. And that's also magical. And so this lower end mage was like, hey guys, attack those two pieces of jewelry this dragon's wearing. Cause now you're close to him. Now you can see him. They don't. They just continue to bounce ice spells on them. And then finally somebody's like, okay, I called shot, the jewelry. And they break it. And all of a sudden this ice, the ice spells they'd been pummeling them with start taking effect. And they drop the dragon down. They wound his wings with shards of ice. Juskard hammers that artifact level pole arm into its back. You know, he's taking burns just being close, but he slams his pole arm down into this dragon's back now with just a pure physical attack. No magic bullshit, no nothing, just gah! And then while the pole arm is in the dragon's back, the druid that had joined the fight casts lightning bolt on it and just hits it like a lightning rod right into the thing. This seriously wounds the worm, and he collapses on some buildings, and then the rest of the people run in, and they start, you know, taking pot shots at him while he's down, and eventually the worm dies. And it's a sad end for the thing, and it's really... That fight should have dragged on even longer, but at that point it had already been going on. I think the end total, after everything was said and done, was that fight took 4 hours, and this is after a 2-year storyline with this dragon tormenting the city. And if I had not made all of the dragon spells shouts, even his breath weapon was a shout, then. It would have gone a little bit better. Even without his shouts, he was able to do a severe amount of damage, both to other characters and to the city. And at the end of the day, the only real complaint I had was the fact that Jaquel, the mage that was in charge of casting silence, wasn't there. And if she, you know, if the character, if the player had been there and the character was in full control, then instead of being an NPC, then what I could have had the worm do was go and attack those mages and potentially kill this character, or at least drive her off. But I didn't want to kill somebody's character when they weren't there. I didn't want to say, oh, welcome back, your character got, you know, killed slash attacked in the fight. So I let them have the win a little bit easier than I should have. But it was still a hard-fought win. This is like 4 hours of combat. Characters got maimed. I believe one lost an arm, like permanently or semi-permanently. A couple of them were burned so bad they couldn't be used for quite some time thereafter. I know several of them were like traumatized, just all the damage it did. But at the end of the day, the player characters won the fight. I'm not disappointed about it. We had a great time. Much fun was had by all. And at the end of it, they said, look, I got one or two complaints, but generally speaking, the characters that had been there a long time, people who had been dying for something grand to do, said that was an epic fight, and they enjoyed it. And even though it was hard fought, they enjoyed the win at the end. And then they spent the next 2 weeks basically divvying up the dragon's bones and skin and shit for items, which is unusual. It's unusual because in a freeform channel, you generally can have your characters have whatever they want. So actually getting useful loot in a freeform fight like that is rare. But there are apparently a lot of people who really wanted things made out of dragon. And now this was their excuse to have dragon bone swords and dragon scale cloaks and things and dragon scale armor and shit like that. So, you know, they got their token items out of it. To this day, you know, at least two of the characters still use weapons that were made out of the thing's teeth and bones. So that's good. And even one of my main characters got something out of it. He offered to buy the brain and they sold it to him. So my necromancer got a dragon's brain. But yeah, it was a great fight. And it was not the best way to go about running a particular campaign, I guess. The takeaway of this story is, number one, if you're running a Great Wyrm campaign, you can make it a long-term campaign. You don't have to have one dragon fight and that's it. It can be a series of fights all the way up. You can have the dragon make multiple appearances and, in fact, engage the player characters a few times before actually settling down to the final fight. And if you're a player, one of the takeaways from this is... situational awareness, especially in a dragon's lair. If you see shit that's dangerous, it's probably dangerous for a reason. If you see portals that are there, they're probably there for a reason. You might want to take them out. Don't get lost in the, oh, I just like slashing at things until I get bored. No, I mean, even in a diced game, that's got to be something. Anyway, I've rambled on for quite some time now. I'm going to call it here. I'm going to try to get more of these RPG story times up because they're fun. You know, just speaking to the camera, being candid, just telling it like it is, telling great stories or at least passable stories of great events. And I hope you've enjoyed listening to me. For now, this has been the RPG Crawler. If you like what you've seen, remember to leave a like, comment if you've got feedback, subscribe for more RPG content. Until next time, take care and goodbye.